Hey, it's Soul. Today's video is the retrospective, the post-mortem, the epilogue, the kind of sort of farewell, okay, not really, to what I think was one of WoW's more successful experiments, Horrific Visions. Now obviously, not everyone feels the same way, for any number of reasons. It's okay to not like Borific Visions or Snorific Visions, the puns. I'm gonna share my personal adventure with you, because that's what Visions did for me. They started a journey of self-discovery. Up until this patch, patch 8.3, I looked at WoW through the most narrow of lenses. A single class, a single spec, a single role. So I'm gonna start with how and why I started this Horrific Vision project.
Ever since the Mage Tower in Legion, we've been looking for a way to provide a more satisfying solo progression experience and a real challenge that you can work towards on your own without needing a group of dungeon players or raiders or a battleground group at your side.
Visions were sold as an optional single player experience, much like the infamous Mage Tower from Legion patch 7.2. That talking point alone grabbed my interest because I really liked the Mage Tower challenge. But notice that I said that singularly. I only completed one Mage Tower challenge in a way that, at least in my head, counted. It felt really good taking down Higher Lord Cruel as a protection paladin because at the time, before the Tomb of Sargeras raid came out with the new legendaries and the increased item level, taking him down was really, really difficult. It took me about 400 or so attempts to bring him down. 400 attempts of mostly doing the same thing over and over again and hoping that, one, I didn't screw up, and two, that the small random elements in that encounter worked in my favor. When I beat it, oh boy, it felt really, really good. But once that high wore off, so did all of my interest in pursuing the Mage Tower challenge on any other class or specialization. Now, I'm going to try to describe my playstyle preferences, which, you know, is my own. You can relate to it, you can bash on it, whatever you like. When I thought of going for the Mage Tower on other classes, I thought to myself, well, okay, I need to get these classes leveled, of course. I need to power up the artifact weapon, so thank you, artifact knowledge. But I wanted to have the legendary items that I thought I needed to perform well. I was lucky with the Paladin. And I knew I needed to be lucky with all of my alts. Knowing that was already extremely discouraging. Now, I know that gear isn't everything, right? But at the time, my mindset was that without these legendaries, whatever, my class didn't feel whole. It was like I was missing an entire talent row full of cool and useful things. And time was ticking before patch 7.2.5, when the Tomb of Sargeras would open and the item level and the Titan Forging maximums went up. Now, we were also told that the Mage Tower would stand for the remainder of the expansion, and the higher level gear that we'd eventually earn would make up for whatever skill or legendaries that we lacked. Eventually, everyone would be able to complete this challenge and collect them, you know, snazzy transmogs. But that didn't make me feel motivated. It actually gave me the opposite feeling that if I can't do it at that level with what I had, why do it at all? So I chose back then, that was the person in the past, I chose to blame Blizzard for not having a legendary vendor of sorts at the time. Now, if there was one, I probably would have felt entirely different. And there's also the circumstance. I mean, I beat the Mage Tower on my Paladin early on, but what if I couldn't beat it? Until later, much later. Then I think I also likely would have felt okay with running the Mage Tower on alts. Instead, this totally irrational pride took over. I wanted to win when it was at its most difficult, or not at all. Sure, I could have always geared down or, you know, any number of things to give myself to simulate that experience after the fact, but that's how I felt at the time. I was too proud to bother with it after the difficulty began to deflate. I ended up completing the challenges on my other Paladin specializations, but otherwise I let the entire feature pass me by because in my head, it didn't feel like I would earn it. I would just be collecting artifact appearances, and that wasn't the incentive for me. The incentive was to prove to myself that I can beat it. So, feel free to judge, alright? I'm not gonna defend myself from the past. So years later, here comes Horrific Visions towards the end of an expansion, and not the middle. There's no item level boosts that remain. In fact, it was nerfed thanks to the removal of Titanforging. The Korok's Revenge event that took place just before the patch 8.3 gave me a full roster of max level characters, thanks. Unlike the days of patch 7.2, getting a character ready is much, much easier. Azerite essences in early 8.3 were still arguably easy enough to obtain, at least getting the rank 2s. Even then, neither those nor Azerite traits were super impactful enough to really alter gameplay, at least at a certain level. So, first things first, I needed to crush Horrific Visions on my main and repeat the victory of the Mage Tower. I needed to prove to myself that I'm decent. I need that, you know, that I could win before something nerfed the content, made it too trivial or much too accessible. Again, being the end of the expansion, it could only get so bad. 8.3 dropped mid-January of 2020, and about 7 weeks later, with an item level of 459, I completed the Mad World achievement, and I felt validated. Cool. Yay! I proved to myself that I can nail it. So here I was at this crossroads again. I was presented with the time and the opportunity to complete a worthwhile challenge on all of these other characters. One big thing that I found to be missing was a Mage Tower-like reward that, you know, earlier I said that it didn't matter. But now that I faced the notion of taking on the same challenge over and over and over again, now that reward was a hole that for many needed to be filled to make completing Visions worthwhile on more than just one character. I admit that it did nag at me. My paladin has this badass flail as a trophy for completing the Mage Tower. Speaking more broadly, celebrating pride as a player isn't expressed well enough from Horrific Visions. It should have been a lot better. It should have offered unique rewards per class, for example. That would have got players a lot more excited. But back to me, I haven't changed much since Legion. I thought back to a few weeks prior when I decided to practice this thought experiment. Like, how hard would it be for a freshly leveled character to at least survive patch 8.3 content, just survive like the daily grind? I took one of my many characters that I leveled through Korok's Revenge, and I had a little bit of an adventure, unlocking Nazhatar, obtaining essences, and working through this 8.3 questline. When I completed that freebie Horrific Vision at the end of that questline on a warrior that was geared like total crap, it still had Warlords of Draenor gear, and yet succeeding at killing Thrall, a few things dawned on me. One is that I clearly don't know how to play this class because I barely scraped by, but two, the little adventure that I had to quickly learn this class and get through the solo content was really stimulating. And so, the project began to take form. To take classes that I barely know how to play, which is pretty much all of them, take them from heirloom gear, and grow stronger by completing only outdoor world content, so emissaries, world quests, world bosses. No warfronts, no LFR, no instance content of any sort, except for, of course, whatever I would get from Visions. The goal was to complete a 5-chest run on every single class on at least one spec. Because come on, I'm not going to do every spec. 12 classes means 36 specs, and then the two maps, Orgrimmar and Stormwind. Do you really want 72 Horrific Visions commentary videos? Don't answer that. The project took roughly 7 weeks, the same as my progression to getting a 5 mask on my main. And when I look back on it, it seems really fast for 11 other characters, so I guess in hindsight, I was clearly putting a lot of time into this. It didn't feel like it really. For my sanity, I was working on characters in small groups, completing assaults and lesser visions for keys, and then later progressing through visions. When I had a lot of spare time, I would try to get at least through the 8.3 quest lines on other characters. So if I did better at that, I could have farmed lesser visions with all my characters, which would have made this whole process faster, save like a week or two of work maybe. So I had the Priest, Hunter, and Death Knight. They made up one of those blocks of characters. And then by the time Echoes of Nyalotha came out, I progressed with the Warlock and the Warrior, followed by the Druid and the Shaman, and then the Monk, Rogue, Demon Hunter, and Mage. They took up the rear, but my schedule got all wonky because of the Shadowlands Alpha. On average, their item level was just under 440. The most effective corruption, at least when it came to 5-chesting, was easily the trusty Tentacle. It was pretty much like a death sentence for most mobs and even elites at higher ranks and item levels. It's Alaria's worst enemy. Unless, you know, the tentacle attacks the eyeball and then I'm like, ugh, stupid tentacle, come on. Given the small availability of trinkets, the most used trinket was the Doom Shroom, something from World Quests, which procs fairly frequently and, you know, for some pretty good damage. The actual best trinket was clearly the punch card trinket with the laser attachment, but I wasn't gonna farm Mechagon rep on every character just for that. My mage was the only character that used that punch card trinket because he was already repped up with Mechagon during 8.2 for those contract recipe things. Other than that, the most I did of Mechagon or Nashatar was to obtain low-level essences before Echoes of Nyalotha became a thing. Speaking of Echoes though, the time played between my characters spiked a lot thanks to Echoes, because now I'm completing emissary quests for the handful of Echoes I get from them. This was the only source of Echoes outside of Visions and Assaults, but it also made clearing Visions obviously more accessible than ever before, and it helped to speed up the project overall. Early gearing for my alts involved just flying around to different world quests to up my item level, so I can break into higher item level brackets. World bosses helped with that too, but there were some big holes in my gearing, notably with weapons. On rare occasions, I would score a 445 weapon emissary, which would be like a huge help, but more often than not, I'd just be stuck with blues. And inside the visions themselves, there were no drops for weapons or rings or trinkets. It's a little baffling, like dang, way to throw me a bone there. Even though I still completed the project, just having a game mode exclude three item types from their loot table was weird, to say the least. But anyway, let's get back to some useless trivia. The top main essence for DPS classes was, by and far, Breath of the Dying, aka Reaping Flames. In a way, this sort of broke the project because of how powerful it was. It was the center of most of my vision strategies, so it was like, use class abilities to AoE down targets, play defensively, and then use Reaping Flames to knock out low health targets as the AoE did its work. But the essences were an 8.3 feature, so hey, anything went. I was leapfrogging the empowered Reaping Flames buff attack thing from mob to mob, one-shotting weak targets until I can unleash a huge opener on big mobs and elites. The most effective minor essence was even more obvious, and that was Purification Protocol. Because the strong AoE would pop smaller mobs, or it would wear them down low enough so that Reaping Flames could finish them off. As artifact knowledge kicked in, my later characters were at or very near the 80s with their Heart of Azeroth, which also made said essences that much more effective. For tanks and healers, their essences were focused on Crucible as their main, and then whatever stats that they could squeeze out of any of the miners. Minor essences overall didn't play all that much into the vision strategy, which made running those roles a bit more, I don't know, maybe pure of an adventure, but it was a little bit less exciting because of their roles. I had to put this somewhere, so here we go. As for add-ons, the only thing that I relied on were deadly boss mods, because it had a module to warn you of all the important casts like Touch of the Abyss or Void Buffet, and because everyone keeps asking, I used nameplate scrolling combat text to display damage values. And shucks, I almost forgot to mention one of the most important factors that made this project successful, and that's the viewers like you, who've been watching the guides and asking for these perspectives. And then of course, there are people on Twitch who've put up with so many of these vision runs on stream. They cheered me on, helped me remember which vials were good, pointed out how awful I was playing, and put up with me whenever I'd forget to use an orb or put on a mask. You folks made the journey that much more special, because I didn't take it alone. And now for some random awards for classes. Apart from Paladins, I think my favorite class to progress with was the Unholy Death Knight. I got a real kick out of this explosive ghoul build, which relied on lots of Vision of Perfection procs to spawn even more ghouls and the Azerite trait that made them explode. So this was before Echoes were available, so rank 2 of Reaping Flames wasn't nearly as effective. I happened to be pretty lucky to get that build, and it made big packs like super trivial. And it was especially nice to have a bunch of ghouls wailing on Alaria when I was fighting her. My least favorite class of them all was the Warlock, because I just couldn't find a really good groove with that class. I almost irrationally dislike destruction. It's not you, it's me, okay? And demonology just wasn't cutting it. Affliction worked because I would just, you know, dot dot dot, and then use Reaping Flames on low health targets. Their only redeeming thing about Warlocks was this one Azerite trait that let me, like, super power up my life drain to a horrifying degree, but overall, I still ended up having the least fun with Warlocks. But it wasn't my hardest class to work with. That award goes to the Shaman, who I just couldn't get comfortable with in the time that I gave to it. The Warlock was easy, it was just dot 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 and then hope I do well. The Shaman, I just couldn't get it. They just had so many more buttons to press and I wasn't sure what to prioritize or what to drop, and of course I was switching between characters, crash coursing myself in all of these classes, and for Shaman I needed to use the most attempts. And like other classes that I struggled with, I needed a rank 11 cloak, which was 65% sanity resistance. I still remember Twitch chats in all caps screaming cap totem, cap totem, cap totem. The easiest class was the Boonkin, hands down. It was almost mean for me to go Boonkin and, you know, rain Starfire on everything. And looking back, I probably should have done it as Feral instead. My thinking at the time was just that I didn't want to run Visions with too many melee classes. The class that I found most surprising, the one that I had a lot more fun with than I thought I ever would, was the Rogue. It took a while for me to bounce between Outlaw and Assassination. I learned that Assassination only used daggers. Who'd have thought, right? And Stealth totally is not my wheelhouse. But being a Stealth class for the first time in something like this, it got me to look at the Vision layout with Stealth eyes, and that gave the runs a fresh feel after having done it so many times on so many other classes. Which leads me to conclude that the design of Visions was mostly balanced for DPS and not tanking or healing. I know, it's almost a no-brainer, but I think it's worth pointing out. As a DPS, I had a bigger toolkit available to me, from the standard abilities to crowd control effects and essences that aren't just Crucible of Flame. Going in as a Demon Hunter tank didn't feel any different from a Paladin, really. Going in as a Discipline Priest and a Mistweaver did have its moments, monks more so because I was going in and meleeing the crap out of things, but from a solo perspective, DPS is the way to go. As someone who doesn't like DPSing, I'm surprised that I came to this conclusion. I eventually came to call the project Horrific Visions for Normal People, because for all my passion for the game, I consider my skill level to be normal. I wanted to simulate the conditions of someone who is, yeah, I don't want to sound mean, but someone who is unexceptional, less geared, less into group activities, you know, normal, whatever. By the end of it, there were factors that sort of contaminated the spirit of the project. Rank 3 essences, for example, previously weren't obtained so quickly. Artifact knowledge shot our necks up tremendously fast after a couple of weeks, and even though I wasn't experienced with any of the classes that I ran with, I was extremely experienced with Visions themselves. But I hope that the project at least gave viewers a perspective that's sufficient experience and know-how matters just as much as that gear that you got from your Mythic 10, that you only farm for because you wanted that weekly chest and not necessarily because you like Mythic Dungeons. The loop between Visions and the 8.3 zone content, it worked. With the recent addition of Echoes and looping Emissaries as an optional source to buy essences, that worked well too. And as much as it may pain some to hear, pacing the cloak upgrade quests by one per week, that worked too. Just recently, I did a special project where I went from a rank 1 cloak to a rank 9 and got a 5 chest done in just over 2 hours. It kind of cheapens the experience if something like that was possible mid-January of this year. But obtaining keys is a somewhat different story. In hindsight, I'm okay with the rate at which we could obtain keys, that is, you know, the number of visions that we can run per character per week, because 8.3 is the sum of its parts, and it's not just Horrific Visions. And Horrific Visions are just 2 maps that can clearly be mastered over time. Having infinite runs with limited rewards as an alternate example, I think that would quickly marginalize the challenge of Visions. That said, limiting the activities to obtain keys to assaults and dailies only, it burned a lot of people out. Today, after another round of significant hotfixes, Emissaries, aka World Quests, contribute to buying keys now, and that's what this system needed, really, alternate paths for keys. But keys did more than just pace runs, they were potentially toxic barriers. So for players in general, a disconnect, a freak accident, or some AFK emergency meant a wasted key and then lost time to get said key. If friends wanted to run together, but one friend ran out of keys, well, tough luck. And if during a run someone were to leave, resulting in a failed run, well, crap, there goes everybody's key. I'm anxious about it, but I hope that this is a lesson learned going into Torghast and the Maw in the upcoming Shadowlands expansion. For me, Herfic Visions proved to be a worthy successor to the Mage Tower Challenge, and the timing of its release made it an overall more fulfilling experience that expanded my interest into WoW's classes that I thought wouldn't be possible. Now, it wasn't perfect either, with a less than prestigious set of rewards, limited variety for a feature meant to be continuously farmed, and a system of entry that felt lopsided and unfriendly to groups. From the Mage Tower to Horrific Visions, players are going to soon travel to Torghast, the next big stage of solo prestige content that is more than just a single encounter or a patch feature. Torghast is going to be one of the pillars that holds the Shadowlands expansion up, along with familiar endgame contents like raiding, dungeons, and PvP, as well as covenants. There are lessons to be learned from both Legion and BFA, and with every alpha build, more lessons to come. Whatever the case, you can count on me to cover this and other features as they come, and maybe I'll be back with a Torghast retrospective. Until then though, thanks for coming by and making it to the end. Please hit that like button if you enjoyed yourself, and let us know in the comments, how was your Horrific Vision experience? How far did you get? Or how long did you last? I hope to see you again soon, but until then, stay safe, stay healthy, and stay breezy.